From the heart of Silicon Valley in California, this is Plug-In 2008, and you've got an exclusive press pass.
2 weeks ago, the state of Russia, or the oil enterprise for the state of Russia, turned off the oil going to the Czech Republic because the Czech Republic made some favorable comments about the way they participate in NATO. They changed their mind after a few days. The Czech Republic did. When things like this happen, a sovereign nation being forced into a foreign policy change by completely irrelevant means, and instead of looking at it as an act of war, our newspapers, if they report it, stick it into a two-column inch story on page 17, which is where it was. I recall the phrase strategic inflection point. That is a phenomenon I noticed with technological change. I concocted this diagram to denote a strange transition point when, if you don't recognize the signs that you are at the transition point, or you don't act on them, you determine the fate of the organization that this discussion refers to. I originally thought of business enterprises and the transitions and transformations that they decide to undertake or not undertake at that point, but I think this absolutely as much refers to societies, to countries, and we may well be at a point corresponding to a strategic inflection point for our country, for the energy industry, which is a $7 trillion industry worldwide. And we are so far doing the very worst that we could do, that I found an organization can do, which is worse even than ignoring that there is such a problem, talking around it, deliberately going out of our way to pretend that the signs are not there. Consider the world around us. There's books being written about the world after the United States, bestsellers. We blame the change, the dramatic change in oil prices to speculation, which, simply put, I don't understand. There are people who pronounce the end of oil, a coined phrase of peak oil, and there are people who treat it like a religious dogma and choose not to believe in it. Meanwhile, we are well aware of globalization in every other context, but we have not considered that globalization applies to forms and sources of energy, like oil that can be put on a boat, and even though it was drilled in the Alaskan Wildlife Preserve, or the shore of California, or in Texas, ends up fueling cars or other uses of energy in whatever continent the boat heads to. The continent that and the country that the boat is most likely to head to is China, which is one of the largest and most dramatic economic stories that is happening in front of our eyes. This is the comparison of the U.S. energy consumption plotted on a semi-log graph, I call attention to that, compared to the Chinese energy consumption, And the only reason I can't prove to you that the two lines have crossed over is because I don't have 2008 data fully available at all for China. We are collectively neglecting the source of our life, energy in various forms. And the phrase, the tragedy of commons, that has various classical origins, but it is basically talking about the simplest form, when you graze, multiple entities graze a territory and they overgraze because it doesn't belong to anybody, and then you starve, is what comes to mind. What is at stake for us is, as my example indicates, not just economic security, which we are witnessing every time we pull up to a pump, but national security, the ability to make our own decisions as a country. We need to adopt a recognition of this problem, and we need to adopt to the concept of a solution, which is to develop a certain degree of immunity, which I call energy resilience, being able to adapt to changing conditions that we cannot control by controlling our own means of adaptation. Let me sketch a diagram to you, which is a simple form of a simple look at the energy industry today. This is a box that shows the customers on the top, the business segments, residential, industrial, and transportation, and all the major energy input elements from coal, renewables, all the way to oil. What is important here is while oil can be used in all three segments, the forms of energy that are used in the other two cannot be used in transportation. There's a wall preventing the ability to mix, which is often called the characteristic of fungibility between different forms of energy. The most important thing we need to do is to transform the energy industry. Not a minor task, $7 trillion industry, in such a way that energy sources can be fully fungible. And what we need for that is transportation that joins the other industrial sector, the industrial and residential sector, in sharing the characteristic of flexibility in being able to use different sources of energy. And that full fungibility, which is a necessity to be able to adapt to unpredictable changes in the energy environment, depends on the introduction of electricity in transportation. Electricity has an additional factor that is in this era of globalization, and boats going from the source of energy to the highest bidder in the world has another characteristic. It is much easier to rely on your local resources if they come to you in the form of electricity, because electricity, so to say, is sticky to the locality where the source of energy was produced and converted into energy. I think most of us would agree with what I've described so far, perhaps not exactly the language or the urgency, but even if you don't, the real question is not to forge agreement on that, but to figure out how do we move forward in this. And I apologize for a pedantic side trip. I want to provide a couple of definitions. For the purposes of this talk, electric car is something that always relies on electricity for its movement. I came up with an unfortunate sounding name, which is only comparable in unfortunate sounding equivalent. I call it dual fuel car because it can use electricity first and gasoline after. It doesn't have any electricity. And I came up with it because I disliked PHEV even more. But let's not get stuck on it. The equivalence having been established, I want to move on and give you a factoid. By every statistic, something like 80% of U.S. drivers drive fewer than 40 miles per day. Not every day, but on average. Consequently, if you magically could convert the fleet of cars into a dual-fuel operation with a 40-mile electric range, the average car would cut gasoline used by more than half. A corollary of this factoid is if you converted just the 100 million large form factor cars on U.S. roads, which are the low end of mileage, that conversion alone would save half of our oil imports and would create a completely different dynamic in the world market for the rest of it. So I would like to propose that our focus, for all of the reasons I talked about, is simplified, and we think of job one, the task that we have to do even if we don't do anything else, is to take a large step toward introducing electricity into transportation. And because of the factors that I proposed, I would like to take aim at the large form factor cars. I can come up with TLAs as well. I'll call them PSVs for pickups, SUVs, and vans. Large form factor, space for retrofits, space for batteries, and lousy mileage. And aim to bring them as a fleet to the 40 mile per day electric range to achieve that half reduction. All of this is summarized there. This is a very hard task. Somebody that knows this area a whole lot better than me said it's borderline undoable. I like that. Otherwise, it's not worth doing. We have issues everywhere. We have issues with infrastructure, battery cost, carbon emission, and most importantly, with ramping up the numbers. Let me address each of those for just a second each. We have enough physical reserve in the grid infrastructure to allow us to build, to convert 50 to 60 million cars, as the intersection of those two lines suggests, large vehicles, before we run into physical infrastructure limitations. The way we do that is we use the grid when people are asleep. The cars can become a distributed storage on the grid and even out the operation of the grid, which most things, when they operate in a steady level, operate more efficiently. Battery costs are a clear problem. Battery volume production is a clear problem. But, you know, I come from an industry, and a lot of us here come from an industry where we have gotten used to a steady reduction with experience, with volume, with technology of the unit cost. I'm referring to Moore's Law. And if we look at the data retrospectively, unbeknownst to most people, battery cost seems to follow a less aggressive Moore's Law, a less steep decline on a semi-log chart than transistors do, but a decline nonetheless. We need to accelerate that decline, because if I take as a target pickup truck, the most popular pickup truck being the Ford F-150 in the United States, for that to have a 40-mile electric range, that chart goes out far too long, 5-6 years. But I don't think we have spent the kind of energy on better technology and better volume-related cost improvements as we have in the semiconductor industry. And I have full confidence that that would introduce a break in that line, making it more steep. Carbon emission comes for free. Carbon emission reduction comes for free. Turns out that because the process of converting in large generator plants, coal, let's talk about coal, to electricity, and then drive the car with electric means is more efficient than using liquid fuel-based engines, ordinary internal combustion engines. The mere act of conversion, without doing anything about the carbon dioxide, that efficiency will give us, for the same number of miles driven, a 50%, give or take 10 percentage point reduction in carbon emission. Not very easy to achieve with a single strategy. If we combine that with taking advantage of the fact that carbon dioxide is water soluble and with suitable governmental policy requiring the removal of the carbon dioxide so that it is not left to the voluntary goodwill of the operators to decide whether they do it or not, but is mandated, like seat belts and everything else in the car industry has been mandated before it happened, I think we could probably increase that percentage in a fairly rapid order in a very major way. But the hardest problem is to do, all of this depends on making, the measures of ramping up new technology, a very difficult task of achieving a meaningful volume. I plotted these are my estimates, the pickups, SUVs, vans that start with 100 million today and gradually go out of service either by conversion, but by obsolescence, by finding their way to Mexico or wherever the old pickups retire. And compare that ramp as time goes on with a build ramp by the automobile companies that is twice as aggressive as the Prius ramp was historically. I use that as a mile stick. It's a pretty aggressive ramp. You do it twice as fast, you get the green line, achieve a 20% penetration in 10 years from now. Not very good. We need to supplement them by looking at a major problem that faces our society and the customers and the automobile industry, making PSVs viable again by retrofitting them to the same type of capability, giving them an electric range ahead of gasoline, and by unleashing the distributed infrastructure of repair shops throughout the country and equipping them in a similar way as CATV, community TV operators, became the cable industry, and mom-and-pop cellular providers became AT&T, do a nationwide development of a franchise chain with the aggregation that follows, we could add a much steeper ramp and bring that OEM, automobile industry, conversion in by a decade. Major existence, which I don't have to convince this room, there's an existing proof that it can be done. And if I can call your attention to my right, two pioneers in this industry are standing next to vehicles that they converted in different technologies, Professor Ali Amadi from Illinois Institute of Technology standing next to a converted, retrofitted Ford 150, and Professor Andy Frank from UC Davis standing next to a converted Equinox. And I would like to ask you to express your appreciation for them because they have suffered. The common fate of pioneers, if they turned around and showed their backs, you would see them. We have a major example, thank you very much, a major example of what a conversion like this took in the creation of the internet infrastructure and the computing devices that populate that infrastructure. It had a lot of factors, a lot of forces. It had entrepreneurs in it. It had large companies reaching across the boundaries and shaking up another industry. It had internal transformation and evolution, like the cable industry was an example. Investments by companies in other industries and technologies that they never expected to make money out, and guess what? They didn't. Intel being a perfect example in its effort in popularizing multimedia on the internet. And finally, the government, which in various, not exactly smooth ways, changed the rules and regulations and the laws that pertain to the regulation of the industry, as they did in the telecom industry, all leading to a atmosphere, an environment in which companies competed and complemented each other, competed with each other and complemented with each other with equal energy on a daily basis. That is what is needed to be done by the companies represented by many of you in this room and an even much larger number who are not. And I woke up to an exceedingly good piece of news that gives me confidence that it is actually possible to do. This is an initiative that I knew nothing about when I wrote that slide. The Wall Street Journal article talking about GM teams with dozens of utilities on plug-in cars. It's a wonderful example of something that I thought was slideware being a reality. The people who did that deserve the same applause because innovation in business operation is just as difficult and just as frustrating as innovation in technology. I suspect EPRI has something to do with this, so let me join you on that one. No good deed shall be unpunished. I would like to take this accomplishment, and now that you can take one step, can you walk? And propose to you a couple of dream actions. I'm looking at the president of EPRI, but I'm looking at many of you because this is going to require a lot of participants. What if you all formed an inter-industry task force with core members from the electric utility industry, that is probably the largest and most well-endowed segment, so they should participate in a fairly active fashion, the auto industry, the high-tech industries, because intelligence in the grid and in the cars is going to be essential, and it's clear from our feasibility proof that academia is, in this case, ahead of the crowd, so they should be participating in it. And we should take our imaginary task force and give them a task. Come up with a plan to produce 10 million dual fuel PSVs on the roads in 4 year time and present this plan to the President of the United States on January 21st. It would be a fantastic move in energizing the country and probably other countries as well, as we could do that. Rebuilding the commons that we've destroyed by our neglect is much harder than most jobs. It requires contributions from otherwise known as sacrifices from all affected parties. First among those is consumers. And no segment of your consumers as a group suffer more than the people who purchased, own money on SUVs, pickups that they have bought from the manufacturers, with consequences on them as well as on the manufacturers. Let me show you a few seconds from PBS on this subject.
To see these lots now and see all these unsold giants is to feel already as if you are wandering in a kind of automotive theme park, a museum almost, a snapshot of entitled times past that will not come again, not in the same way anyway. The SUV is about to become a thing of the past, a swaggery relic of days gone by.
Our collective industries are as responsible for this piece of the destruction of the commons as the consumers themselves. We can't point fingers. We have to roll up our sleeves and go to work. We need to develop a retrofit industry for this. And this is a perfect place where we need to ask for assistance from our government to help grease the skids to that and help first enable the consumers to do this investment at a time when they are bedraggled by the gasoline price anyway and the ongoing problems in the economy, and ask for a contribution from the one more point I want to make. I'm not asking for a handout. I'm asking for a redeployment of tax revenues. Make it more expensive to use gasoline in power boats, planes, low mileage vehicles, and ship the money over to make people, allow people to enter the retrofitted universe and use much cheaper, much more friendly to the security and the well-being of this country, electric means, two-pronged. I would put the requirement that this becomes revenue neutral so far. In addition to that, I want to go to our hosts and be as ungrateful as I can be for this lunch. There is no free lunch. The cost of this lunch is you need to help change consumer behavior by providing the mileage of these cars for 1 year, 2 years, whatever we feel is feasible, free. Remember, it's not very expensive to the utilities. The infrastructure, unused, is sleeping there. You just take a little bit of relatively inexpensive coal, burn it, and give it away to the consumers, even as the as time goes on, intelligence that will allow you to charge later is being put in place. That's not enough. I would like to ask the government to create a special federal court district patterned a little bit after the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit that has been created to deal with patent litigation in a more expeditious form, and give them the task to take care of intellectual property that inevitably flourishes when a problem is being solved and like a hydra grabs the participants' ankles, and pretty soon the whole game becomes an intellectual property fight. Give an efficient and knowledgeable means of disposing of these disputes, keeping the public interest in mind. I would also, at the same time, like to ask the automotive manufacturers to look toward the open source movement and adopt its principles to specifications, so the batteries and control systems, at least at the interface level, can be standardized, and also commit not to use withholding of warranties as a tool to slow down something that undoubtedly some portion of them will regard as a business challenge. We need money. There's an awful lot of talk about green tech around here. No green tech is as green as this tech. I would like to see the venture capital community participate in introducing what they know, what they're supposed to know well, the merits of intelligent risk-taking into an industry that has been less risk-taking than some. And I would like the SBA to fuel the growth of the delivery infrastructure once it's established by the venture money. Most importantly, second to most importantly, I would impose the requirement that this task force creates an atmosphere where the individual members don't lobby the U.S. government for their stovepipe interests. All the discussions and arguments take place in the conference room, hammered out, and the industry task force, as an industry, goes and asks these things of the U.S. government. Much to learn from the Japanese, who have done this much more effectively in the industry dealing with the government than we have, but there's also room for continuous improvement in our business practices. Rebuilding the commons requires difficult work. My most difficult of them all is to develop a cooperative problem-solving attitude that somehow happened in the internet universe. Those were easier years, better years. I was younger too. But maybe we can do that if we recall the environment, if you're old enough for that, what it was like when we faced war in this country. We did not have the automobile manufacturers run to the White House to offer to convert their factories to produce airplanes below cost. We did not have a labor force grow out of nothing to replace the male workers from this industry who were fighting a war in the two continents away. Women joined the workforce in a very aggressive fashion for the first time in large numbers and changed labor policy forever as a result. But on the way, the government, the car companies, the soldiers, and the women won World War II, which is why we are here and talk about it. My feeling is that we are facing a clear and present danger similar to what that generation faced, and the magnitudes and the lessons of oil even were present in that generation. And I have to end on my recalling a very important battle of World War II, the Battle of Stalingrad. Early years of the war, the German army was heading to occupy Moscow. No country has occupied the capital of Russia ever, and it was a very major aim of the Third Reich and Hitler to be the first to do that. In the middle of winter, they peeled off a substantial portion of their military forces and sent them south to a nondescript city on the Volga called Stalingrad. And the Russians threw everything they had at defense and surrounded and defeated the German attack. 1.5 million people died in that battle, making it arguably the most expensive in terms of casualties battle in recorded history. This is known. Less documented and less obvious, but as you think about it and dig a little bit, it's very clearly obvious what that battle was about, why it was so important to forget Moscow and make those casualties. That thrust was for access to the oil fields near Baku. There is that famous saying or cliche that those who don't remember history are destined to relive it. There is the new movie that, slightly paraphrase, gives me my last slide. It is up to us to rebuild the common and make that not be so. Thank you very much.